I was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I'd failed, but you were my redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost,
now found by the Father.
I've been changed from a I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing,
time for the children's message with Miss Lori.
Good morning, good morning. Come on up. I know I got up here first, so I can go backwards. Come on up, everyone. With your brother, come on up. That's okay too, no worries. When you're ready, no rush. Oh, sorry, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to get on your kitty. How is everyone doing today? You guys all doing good? You guys look like you're having fun over there. I'm glad y'all are doing good. I have to ask you a question though. Can you all tell me a time, and our friend over here is really helping me out with this, can you tell me a time you've been really sad?
I can.
You can? What's a time you've been really sad?
When Kaylee got hurt,
when our friend got hurt, that was a time you were really sad? What's a time that you were really sad? When somebody died, that would be a time that we're really sad. I can hear that one of our friends is really sad right now. Sometimes it just happens during the day. We get really sad over things. What about you guys? Do you know a time you were really sad? Yes, no. Well, no matter what, we all get sad sometimes throughout the day. And when we're sad, what happens? What happens? What happens when you're sad? What did you do when Kaylee was hurt?
Cried.
You cried, okay. And then what did your friend do? You ran over there and checked on her and asked if she was okay. Did you give her a hug? Yes. Because when we're just like that, exactly. Because when we're sad, be careful. You guys good? Okay. Watch out. I don't want you to get hurt with all those wires behind there. Our guitar gentleman's probably looking like, oh man, that's some equipment back there. You good? Okay. So when we're sad, can we sit up real quick so our audience can, so everyone can see us? So when we're sad, we can give each other hugs. And when we give each other hugs, that provides us comfort, right? It makes us feel a little bit better. Maybe when we're sad, our moms might give us a hug, or our dads might give us a hug, or grandmas or grandpas, or even siblings or friends. They comfort us. We've been learning about those Beatitudes, remember, where Jesus is talking about people that's blessed? Today we hear that blessed are those who mourn. Do you know what mourn means? It's kind of a hard word. Oh, thank you. Sad over the loss of someone. Exactly right. When we're mourning, we're sad over the loss of someone. But the rest of that is, blessed are those who mourn, for they are comforted. They're going to be comforted too. Just like when we're sad, we're comforted. Who can comfort all of us no matter what?
God.
God, that's exactly right. And his son Jesus, you're exactly right. And his son Jesus, they can comfort us anytime. What do we have to do to get God and Jesus to comfort us? Pray. What do we have to do? We have to pray. Even though we might not be able to see it, we can feel it. We can feel that peace and that love of God. You're exactly right.
Because everybody has peace and love of God, and when someone loves you, then you get God's love too.
You're right that everyone has the peace and love of God, and when we share love with others, you're feeling that love too. You're exactly right. Actually, yes. It's not just God and Jesus that can comfort us. It's other people because God is in their heart too. Guys, I think you know this so well. You're exactly right. That's exactly what Jesus wants us to do, is comfort other people just like he comforts us. Or you can comfort yourself through when we pray and when we talk to God. So let's go ahead and turn and talk to God now. So let's go ahead and fold our hands and bow our heads and repeat after me, and congregation, repeat after me too. Dear God, thank you so much, for the comfort you provide us. Help us to always know we can turn to you, and you will always be there to comfort us. even in our saddest times. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, we are going to head down our kids' hall for our kids' Christian formation, and you'll either pick up down the hall or we'll come back in here for communion today.
Technical difficulties. I was going to do a mic drop after that children's message this morning, but I don't want to damage our equipment. So, each week during our eight blessings series, we will focus on one beatitude or blessing from Matthew's Sermon on the Mount. This week, it is Matthew chapter 5, verse 4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Then Jesus says more on the subject in John 16, 4b through 7 and 16 through 20. I didn't say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you, but now I go away to the one who sent me. None of you asked me, where are you going? Yet because I have said these things to you, you are filled with sorrow. I assure you that it is better for you that I go away. If I don't go away, the companion won't come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. Soon you won't be able to see me. Soon after that, you will see me. Some of Jesus' disciples said to each other, what does that mean? Soon you won't see me, and soon after that you will see me. And because I'm going to the Father. What does he mean by soon? We don't understand what he's talking about. Jesus knew they wanted to ask him, so he said, are you going to try to find out from each other what I meant when I said, soon you won't see me, and soon after that you will see me? I assure you that you will cry and lament, and the world will be happy. You will be sorrowful, but sorrow will turn into joy. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God.
Join your hearts in prayer with mine. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, and take the words which Mike has read. Come, Holy Spirit, and take the words that I now speak. Come, Holy Spirit, and take our hearts and our minds, that as we hear your word proclaimed, you, by your spirit at work in us, might reshape us to look more like Christ. Amen. This week we continue a summer worship series exploring this beloved passage of scripture called the Beatitudes. As they're presented in the first 12 verses of the Sermon on the Mount in the fifth chapter of Matthew's Gospel. The Beatitudes are eight blessings that Jesus offers that often don't sound like blessings. In our world, we might think, blessed are the content, or blessed are the joyful, or blessed are the rich. But Jesus turns our notions of being blessed upside down, as he turns so many things upside down. Each week during this series, we will take a look at one verse or one beatitude, and another passage of scripture that helps us to explore or understand that beatitude. This week we turn to Matthew chapter 5, verse 4, and an accompanying passage from John 16 as we explore how sorrow might be a blessing, even though mom's not really feeling it right now. The beatitude that we hear from Jesus is this: blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. If we were to picture ourselves back in Galilee as a part of the crowd different understanding of grief and mourning than we do here in Virginia Beach in 2022. In the ancient Near Eastern culture, mourning was much more formal, it was much more expressive, and it was much more extended than our rituals of mourning and grief are today. According to the New Interpreter's Dictionary of the Bible, grief was to be displayed back then very publicly and very loudly. Not to do so was considered insulting to the dead and to the grieving relations, as it implied a lack of affection and respect for the dead, for their family, and for the clan and the nation as a whole. Rituals of mourning back then could last at least 7 days. At the time of the burial, the women would begin the burial procession from the house of the deceased, and they would be wailing and weeping the whole way along the route of the funeral procession, and other bystanders would join them along the way. That looks very different from the way funerals look in our culture. Amen. Funeral rituals may look different, but I think that Jesus' words are just as relevant for us today as they were then. They are a timeless lesson for all of us who are human, because the experience of loss is a part of the human condition. We don't merely experience the loss of individuals that we love. We experience the loss of dreams, the loss of a marriage, the loss of a job, the loss of memory, the loss of mobility. All of these are things for which we feel deep sorrow. We can also experience collective loss. We as people can experience loss together. Think of the losses that we have all walked through over the last several years during the COVID pandemic. Think of the loss of rights and privileges that many experience when laws change overnight. Think of the losses experienced by cultures and communities. As many of you know, I had the great joy of traveling this week to the Appalachian Service Project with our team of 18 folks. We worked in three different teams helping three different homeowners make their homes warmer, safer, and drier. We also played lots of card games, gave one another fabulous nicknames, and created a large bug cemetery in our sleeping area, or at least the girls did. In the midst of this work and fun, we also learned a lot about Appalachian culture. One of the things that struck me was the clarity with which we heard the message of mourning. Most of the community leaders and many of the citizens in Appalachia are already aware that an economy that was built on coal for nearly a century is coming to an end. Not only is the need for coal lessening on a global scale as we look for different renewable energy that will help address our climate crisis, but the methods of coal mining started changing several decades ago, and they have become more mechanized. Coal can still be extracted from plenty of sites in the area, but fewer people are required for that to happen, much fewer people, thanks to the technologies that are more efficient from the perspective of the coal companies anyway. The coal mining way of life is dying out, and the Appalachian people are in the process of dreaming about what is next for their communities. But in the midst of that dreaming, they also mourn. They grieve a way of life that sustained them for so long. When we mourn, whatever we are mourning, whatever loss we are experiencing in our lives, we are a people who need comfort. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. In our second lesson from today, from John 16, we hear a part of Jesus' farewell discourse to his disciples who were gathered together for a final meal on the evening that he was betrayed. At this meal, which we remember in worship later today, a day before his execution, Jesus talks about sorrow. He knew the disciples would mourn his death, that even after the resurrection, they would live with a nagging sense of his absence. And so Jesus promises them comfort. But we don't always feel that comfort. Yes, we know the promise of the Holy Spirit. We know that Jesus promises to be with us always. And we believe that God is near the brokenhearted. We believe that, and we know it in our heads. But the truth is, when we are in the midst of deep mourning, we don't always feel the comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen? So let's look more closely at the word comforted. What did Jesus mean by comfort? The Greek word for comforted is parakleo. It's similar to the word paraclete, which is the word in Greek for the Holy Spirit. When we dig into the meaning of parakleo and what it means to be comforted, we discover that it means to draw closer to someone's side, to summon, to encourage, or to strengthen. This beatitude, this blessing, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. It doesn't mean that the pain of loss is going to go away, it's going to disappear. The comfort that Jesus provides is not necessarily going to erase pain or completely ease the burden of grief. When we are parakleo, when we are comforted by the presence of the Holy Spirit draws us closer to her side, summons us to keep on going, encourages us to breathe deeply and move forward, strengthens us to do what needs to be done. Comfort doesn't always look like no more pain, no more despair, no more hard days. Comfort for those who mourn often looks like the Holy Spirit inching us closer and closer to the triune God in spite of the pain or the wounds or the trauma. Comfort looks like the Holy Spirit offering us ways to move forward, to keep the memories of the past alive, even as we chase new dreams that God has for us, just like the Appalachian people are doing. One of the folks I met this week is Heston Anderson, who married Emily in June. Emily Jackson grew up here at Haygood. She's the granddaughter of Nancy Traylor. She's an ASP alum, and she brought her husband, Heston, to ASP. Was it 2 weeks after their wedding or three? And they didn't have a honeymoon, so this was their honeymoon. Let me say, it was not a luxurious honeymoon. About midway through the week, probably during a game of spades, and probably because I was trying to distract him, I asked Heston about the two rings that he wears on the middle fingers of each of his hands. He explained that the ring on his right hand is his high school class ring. The ring on his left hand belonged to his grandfather, to whom he was very close. They spent a lot of time together when Heston was growing up, and after he got his class ring, he and his grandfather would bump their rings as a sign of success or just a sign of affection to each other. When his grandfather died in recent years, Heston said to himself, "I gotta have that ring." Now he wears his grandfather's ring on his left hand, his ring on his right hand, and he bumps them together to remember, to feel the presence of his grandfather, to keep his memory alive in his life. As soon as I heard that story, I thought, that's a sign of the Holy Spirit's comfort. That's one way that in the midst of his mourning, Heston can keep his grandfather's memory alive and present in the new life that he and Emily are building together. I expect that many of us have things like that, that strengthen us in the midst of our moments of loss. I invite you in the week ahead to think about your own seasons of loss and look for the ways that the Holy Spirit has drawn close to us, has strengthened us to keep us moving forward. I invite you to do that, and I invite you to be aware of those around you that are experiencing loss and mourning, because God might be willing to use you as a way of strengthening and encouraging them. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. This week we celebrate all the ways that our gifts made a difference in that Appalachian Service Project mission trip. You and your gifts kept the team hydrated, supplied the team with gas for their vehicles, and undergirded their work with prayer. You made a difference this week, not only to the 18 team members, but to the people of Appalachia. You may give financial gifts to Haygood online by placing a check in the offering bowl in the lobby or by mailing a check to us. Before we continue in our worship, a couple of congregational prayer concerns to share to make you aware of. We want to hold Denise Becker in our prayers. Denise had shoulder replacement about a week and a half ago. She's home, doing well, but anybody who's had shoulder replacement will tell you that that is a journey of getting back to full strength. We also want to hold Jerry Payne in our prayers. Jerry lost his sister yesterday. And we want to remember that next Saturday at 1, we'll be celebrating the life of Martha Peel here in our sanctuary. This morning, we respond to God's word by sharing together at the table. We will have two stations at the head of the center aisle right over here. We invite you to come up by the center aisle and return to your seats by the side aisles. Sharon, could I ask you to go find some antibacterial? I call it goop in my house. I was trying to think of the right word for it. We will ask you to come up the center aisle and return to your seats by the side aisles. As you come forward, we invite you to hold your hands out like this so that we can place a piece of bread in them, really just make a shape of a cross, and then hold your hands out like this. Thank you so much. All of our servers will sanitize their hands and will be wearing masks as they serve. After you receive your piece of bread, you can take an individual cup of juice from the tray that will be extended to you. We also do have gluten-free communion available, so if you need gluten-free communion, come to the station that'll be on your left side. You can consume communion while you're standing at the front, or you can return to your seats to consume it, whichever you prefer. Finally, we remember that this meal over which we give thanks is Christ's gift to us. And when Christ gives us a gift, he doesn't put any restrictions on it, no boundaries. So this is a table that is open to everyone. It doesn't matter where you are in your walk with Christ, whether you've been baptized or not. It doesn't matter how young you are, how old you are. These gifts of God are for all God's people, and all are able to come. We prepare our hearts for the table by confessing our sins before God. I invite you to join me in the responsive prayer of confession that'll be on the screens in front of you. I will offer a blessing, and you all get to offer the woes as we turn to God in prayer. Blessed are we when we let go of possessions, for the kingdom of God unfolds in open places. Woe to us when we gather into barns, for soon this life will be over. Blessed are we who know the ache of hunger, for the empty places in body and soul are the fertile soil for new growth. Woe to us who fill our lives to capacity, for we fail to recognize what is missing. Blessed are we who know sorrow, for the ache of love lost is witness to the seed planted. Woe to us who have yet to know the pain of grief, for the fullness of love is woven with sorrow. Blessed are we who know scorn, for the rejection of humans keeps us mindful of that beyond. Woe to us who depend on the approval of others, for to dance with spirit appears foolish. Blessed are we who live in the harmony of life in the spirit, for we will recognize abundance. Amen. Will you join me in prayer over our table? Always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Holy God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is right and good. From the rising of the sun to its setting, your name is praised among all peoples. In the power of the Spirit, you created all things, blessed them, and called them good.
You called to yourself a people, and at the right time you came and dwelt among us as one of us, bringing good news to the poor, healing to the sick, raising the dead, sharing table with the unrighteous, and teaching the way that leads to life. By your incarnation, life, suffering, execution, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery, and made a new covenant with us by water and the Spirit. On the night of your betrayal, Lord Jesus, you took bread, you blessed it and broke it and gave it to your disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." You did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "The cup that is poured out is the new covenant in my blood." In remembrance of all you have done to save us, Blessed Trinity, we offer ourselves to you in prayer and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Now pour out your Spirit upon us. Pour out your Spirit on these gifts. Make these gifts be the body and blood of Christ, and make us through them, Christ's body, alive in the world. Come, Lord Jesus, and be our daily bread. And then send us to the world until that day when the world gathers at your table forevermore. Amen. And now, with the confidence of God's children, let us pray the prayer that Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all share in the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. The table is ready. Let us keep the feast. I'll invite our service to come forward, and our band is going to receive first so that they are able then to lead us in song.
Rachel, the body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you, Sarah. Chris, the body of Christ given for you. Carrie, the body of Christ given for you. Clint, the body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you, Audrey. Grace is abundant. The body of Christ given for you, Nash.
I am surrounded on every side. Can't see the light of day, but I am persuaded beyond all hope. You won't let go of me. I stake my claim on every word you say. You will not be late. I will sing through fire and thunder. Thank you.
for the ways that you feed us through bread and cup, so that we might go and feed the world with your love. Send us in the strength of your Spirit to be the hands and feet of Christ. Amen. Will you stand as you're able as we sing our commitment?
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. The lowest value.